Good evening and welcome everyone to the National Humanities Center Humanities in Class webinar series. Tonight's session is titled, How to Break Up with Your Favorite Racist Children's Books. And I'm joined by Philip Nell, University Distinguished Professor of English at Kansas State University. Today is January the 18th, 2022. My name is Andy Mink. I'm the Vice President of Education at the Center. And on behalf of my staff, Jira and Mike and Meredith, I want to welcome all of you to tonight's webinar. The year has gotten off to the same kind of inauspicious start that 2021 seemed to bring us, and I fully recognize that all of you have challenging and disrupted jobs that your professional attention to not only the content and the curriculum that you're responsible for, but maybe more importantly now, maybe it always was, the children that you're working with, the students that you're mentoring and helping get through this complicated time. We really do appreciate you spending 90 minutes with us in the middle of the school week. In particular, as I look around the room, I'm always inspired and thankful, grateful for all the teachers, all the educators who join us from around the country. I know Drew's joining us, perhaps for the first time. Drew is joining us from Winslow Unified School District in Arizona. Great to have Teresa here. She's at Hillsborough Community College, which I believe is just outside of Tampa. Always nice to have Kennesaw State folks in the room. Lauren and Megan are here from Atlanta. Thank you for joining us. Melissa's here from Bristol Middle School in Connecticut, not so far from her. Robert from the Landmark School in Massachusetts is with us as well. Ashley's in Kansas City, and as always, we have numerous Los Angeles Unified folks. Always great to have LA in the house tonight. Tinny, Clarice, Berenice, and Leonardo from Westminster Elementary School are all here from LA. Again, thank you so much for joining us for this webinar. The National Humanities Center, located in Durham, North Carolina, really does conceive of itself, I think, as a place for these kinds of conversations. That is, for scholars and experts and folks who really dedicate their lives to understanding the nuance of the ways that we see ourselves and the identity we have. Folks like Professor Nell tonight and his colleague Lisa Tadinetti, who was with us as a fellow several years ago. And it's always equally inspirational for me to work with scholars who have a deep understanding and dedication to offering their voices to help with these solutions. And doing so with educators, with teachers, side by side in a very collegial way is really the purpose of this activity and many of those in our education department. You can find all of the resources that we provide in support of this work in our Humanities in Class digital library. This open education resource library is free and open. There's two good things about that phrase, there's free and open. The first is it doesn't cost you anything and it never will. The second is that you can trust that the work there is accurate, the work there is emergent, that the copyright conditions have been placed so that you have all the faith in the world that you can use it with your students and in your instruction and in your classroom. It's important for us that you see this as not only a place to get those materials, but also to evaluate, to remix, and perhaps even to contribute your own. Take a look at the webinar series group and you'll find the readings and the associated materials for all of our webinars, including tonight's session. And of course, this is where we'll place the recording of tonight's session afterwards. That will be in its full, in its entirety, but it'll also be edited by topics so that there might be a particular section of tonight's talk that you find really valuable that you'd like to revisit, perhaps you'd like to share with colleagues, or perhaps you'd even like to share it with some of your students. One of the nice things about the digital library is it also allows the center to support and partner with organizations from across the nation and across the humanities fields to also offer their materials in these free and open manner. And I'm very pleased, both as a former board member and organization member, to welcome Larry Paske, Executive Director of the National Council for the Social Studies, who is in fact one of those partners. Hey, Larry, can you hear me?
I can hear you just fine. Hopefully you can hear me as well.
I can, and it's always nice to be in the same room with you, albeit a virtual one. I hope you're doing well, and we're anxious to hear a little bit about the ways that NCSS might not only support this topic, but support all the educators in the room tonight.
Absolutely. Thanks, Andy, and it's great to be back with you as well and your team at the National Humanities Center. So it's a pleasure to virtually meet most of you. I'm excited to participate in tonight's program with you. So I am the Executive Director of National Council for the Social Studies. We are a proud supporter of this program through a project we have with the Library of Congress's Teaching with Primary Sources program. At NCSS, we envision a world where all students are educated and inspired for lifelong inquiry and informed civic action. And part of our project is to foster this conversation around how we use primary sources, how we use texts like those we'll be talking about tonight, to think about what it means to engage in meaningful inquiry and be prepared for a life of active civic engagement and learning. We invite you to learn more about the Library of Congress and their Teaching with Primary Sources program as well. Our work with them will result in methods texts for pre-service teachers and methods professors. We anticipate those being released later this year, and they are designed around inquiry questions and topics much like the one we're going to be participating in tonight. If you're not too familiar with the C3 framework, I do invite you to learn a little bit more about it. The C3 framework is built off of an inquiry arc, and that arc is modeled on four different dimensions. The first dimension, I'm having trouble queuing it up, is developing questions and planning inquiries. Based on the questions you develop in a classroom, you apply different disciplinary tools and concepts. So the questions you may ask might be rooted in history. They might be rooted in civics, economics, geography, one or more. Some of you are in states, and I see many of you from California tonight, Virginia, and of course many other states as well. Many of you are in states that have used the C3 framework as part of their state standards or state curriculum. Your district may also be one that has used the C3 framework for instructional purposes as well. So this is a framework that you can adapt in your classroom. As you figure out how you are applying the questions you ask, what sources are you using and what evidence are you using? Many of you in the chat tonight are already asking questions and kind of interrogating the types of sources that you use, and that very much is part of the inquiry process that we support at NCSS. But most importantly is that last dimension, and that's really where we think the heart of inquiry comes alive. It's communicating conclusions and taking informed action. What do we do with the conclusions that we've drawn, and how do we inspire our students to make meaning of those conclusions and make meaning of the sources they've used, to think about what kinds of actions they may take in their lives, whether they're small actions or big ones like going for a career working in the public sector, for example. So again, we invite you to think about the role of inquiry in social studies, regardless of where your district or state is in curriculum planning or how the C3 framework or models like it have been used in your curriculum. We just really support the role of inquiry, and you being a part of this tonight, I think, helps foster the spirit of inquiry together in social studies. The last thing I'll say, this is my compelling question for all of you tonight. Are you democracy ready? Whether you're democracy ready or you want to be democracy ready, we do invite you into a very special virtual conference that we are supporting in just a few weeks. Visit us at socialstudies.org/NCSS100 to learn more about our special week-long virtual conference. It's a complete celebration of our centennial year. We do feature many speakers that might be of interest to you as well. We are excited to bring Ibram Kendi on to talk about his work. We are bringing back three former U.S. Secretaries of Education to discuss the federal role of policy in active civic engagement. And our closing keynote speaker is Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor, who has a special conversation with educators. So I do invite you all to come to our celebration. And I also invite you to learn a little bit more about us at NCSS. Again, we're a proud supporter of this series. If you'd like to learn more about the C3 framework, membership in NCSS, or just have general questions with us. And at the very least, please follow us on Twitter and join in the conversation about inquiry, and especially conversations about inquiry in children's literature like we are having tonight. So again, my best to all of you. Thank you so much for the hard work you're doing this year, especially. And your being here tonight, I know, is just a testament to how we're all trying to think together about how to create meaningful spaces for social studies to come alive in our classrooms and for all of our students. So thank you so much for all you are doing. And I'll turn it back to you, Andy, and I'm excited to join you tonight.
Thanks so much, Larry, and thanks again to NCSS for its continued partnership with the Center. Larry, I'm going to invite you, as you remain with us tonight, to feel free to chat in the chat box, drop links, drop your contact information, and use that space to further communicate what you shared tonight. I also invite our audience to take a look at the upcoming webinar series. I think tonight is number 23 out of 40, so we're a little over halfway there. And as I was looking through the themes for the rest of the spring, I noticed that, much like tonight, there are sessions that, you know, work to the heart of this notion of interrogating the icons, of trying to unpack and discover the nuance of not only the assumptions that we've made, the things we've been taught, and the things that we're comfortable with, but try to consider the context within which those things sit. For example, Kate Masur will be joining us on February the 8th to discuss the many, many ways that Abraham Lincoln is misquoted, particularly in current political conversation. Gene Theo Harris will be joining us actually a week prior to that, they're out of order, to discuss the rebellious life of Rosa Parks. Later in February, Matt Garcia from Dartmouth will be joining us to add a lot more context to Cesar Chavez and the legend that he was. And then finally, Thomas McDowell from Ohio State will be working with us on finding the historical roots of Wakanda and Black Panther. Please do join us and share these with your colleagues. As always, I want to thank the Teacher Advisory Council for its ongoing contributions and hard work. These 20 educators have remained loyally engaged with the center over this pandemic year, the second pandemic year. And I want to thank them for the ways in which they've reviewed our materials. They've offered thoughts and connections to the relevance in the classroom and generally been advocates for us in their networks and their professions. As you know, tonight's webinar is audio only. However, your voice is going to be critical. The chat box, the audience chat box, is a great way to chatter with each other, to share links, to offer URLs, to respond with comments. But if you want to ask something specifically to Professor Nell tonight, please do locate that Ask Professor Nell tab. Drop that question in that tab, and as the moderator, I'll cue those up and I'll bring those forward to Professor Nell when the time seems appropriate. If you have any kinds of issues tonight, technical issues or otherwise, you can troubleshoot on your own screen. I hate to say it, I wish it were more complicated. Oftentimes, the most effective way of dealing with any kind of glitch is simply to log out and come back in. If you do that, it will not disrupt us, and it will also not disrupt your certification of attendance. Once again, you have joined the Humanities in Class webinar series for tonight's episode titled, How to Break Up with Your Favorite Racist Children's Book. And I'm joined by Philip Nell. He is the University Distinguished Professor of English at Kansas State University. We're also joined tonight by Jennifer Ansbeck. Jennifer is a English teacher at Manchester Township High School in Manchester Township, New Jersey. Jen is a past TAC member, 2019-20, and she'll be in the chat box sharing some associated materials that she's discovered and will bring forward for ways to connect this with your classroom. Jen, thanks for being here. Hey, Professor, can you hear me over there in Kansas?
I can.
Thank you for being patient with us. Thank you for joining us tonight. I know you've got a lot of wonderful things to share. Here's a quick question for you before you start the PowerPoint and begin in leading us through this narrative. Can you tell us what all of four of our lead-up songs to tonight's webinar had in common?
Well, they all reference Dr. Seuss.
They do. And, you know, it was kind of funny to me when I began to research songs that somehow reference Dr. Seuss. And, of course, the first ones I found were Prince, Run DMC, Quest, you know, these bands that you don't really associate with children's lit. And it occurred to me that once you notice it, once you allow yourself to realize it, Dr. Seuss must be in so many cultural touch points. When, as you begin to do, you can't stop seeing Dr. Seuss now. Have you found that to be
true? Yeah, I mean, Kool Moe Dee once said that he learned to rap from listening to Muhammad Ali's rhymes and from Dr. Seuss. So, I mean, there's actually a lot I could say about hip-hop and Seuss, but maybe that's for another day.
Well, or maybe it actually ties really well in the sense that this isn't just an isolated conversation about a certain author and a certain series of books, regardless of how popular, but these things are really embedded in our identity. And I'm looking forward to how you walk us through untangling that complicated relationship tonight.
Well, thanks. And good evening to everyone, or good afternoon, or good whatever time it is where you are right now. And thanks, Andy, and thanks to the National Humanities Center for inviting me. It's a great honor to be asked. I begin by acknowledging that the state of Kansas, which, as Andy says, is where I am, is home to the Kaw, Osage, and Pawnee nations. And today, Kansas is home to four federally recognized Native nations: the Prairie Band Potawatomi, the Kickapoo Tribe of Kansas, the Iowa Tribe of Kansas and Nebraska, and the Sac and Fox Nation of Missouri in Kansas and Nebraska. So the land that serves as the foundation of Kansas State University, which is where I teach, was and still is stolen land. I will start with a 65-minute talk, leaving time for questions and further conversation. so maybe you'll disagree with something I've said, or you'll want further elaboration, or you'll just have a question about racism in children's literature. Make note of those questions. Feel free to pose them via the Ask tab, as Andy says, or, you know, at the end. And as I hope you can see on the screen there, there are racist images. I don't know who can see your screen, but please take care of yourselves and any in your care. And each time, I will announce the racist image in advance, and then I'll tell you when it's gone again. So I think I'm now known as the guy who called out Seuss's racism. I'm okay with that, but you should also know two other things. First, Katie Ishizuka and Ramon Stevens, the duo behind The Conscious Kid, a website and resource I recommend, deserve co-credit. My article on Seuss and Blackface Minstrelsy came out in 2014, and it became the title chapter of Was the Cat in the Hat Black in 2017. But they also published a report in 2017 and an article in Research and Diversity in Youth Literature in 2019, and that article goes into much more depth on racism in Seuss's work, and it's open access, so go to it, check it out. Also, via their social media presence, they have been really active in keeping the focus on racism in Seuss's work. The second thing you should know by way of introduction here is that my relationship with Dr. Seuss is complicated. I credit him and Sesame Street with teaching me not only how to read, but why. That show and Seuss's books taught me that reading is fun. I vividly remember being 3 years old and finishing Green Eggs and Ham, the first book I had read all by myself. And though I did not know it then, the book uses rhyme to give clues to pronunciation and limits itself to only 50 different words, ideal for a beginning reader. In fact, I so enjoyed finishing the book that guess what I did next? I reread it. So Green Eggs and Ham is both the first book I read and the first book I reread. And that love of reading led me to decide on an English major, to earn a PhD in English, and I bet you can see where this is going, to become a scholar of Dr. Seuss. I'm also the author of the biography and timeline, in fact, on the official Dr. Seuss website, Seussville, which appeared there from 2010 until I think last year. While I was putting this talk together, I discovered that they've removed my bio and the timeline from the site, so hopefully they'll be updating it to address the racism in his work, which is something that they would not let me do when I wrote it. But to be fair to Dr. Seuss Enterprises, before writing Was the Cat in the Hat Black, my own record on Seuss and racism was mixed. In my earlier work, I do a fair job at addressing the racism in his cartoons, but a poorer job at addressing the racism in his picture books. For example, and warning, racist images in the next three slides, in Dr. Seuss' American Icon, I do call out this African Islander Eureka caricature in If I Ran the Zoo, but I also call it an exception, and that's wrong. While it is true that overtly racist images are far more common in Seuss's earlier cartoons than in his later picture books, this image is not an exception. The racist Mountains of Zomba Matant, which is from the same book, The Helpers Are All With Their Eyes at a Slant, also is in If I Ran the Zoo, and I actually make note of that fact some 40 pages later in my same Dr. Seuss American Icon book. But in my earlier work, I present Seuss as an artist who, as he became more aware of racism, and in fact, wrote some picture books that he intended as anti-racist parables, also created work that is less racist. I presented him as an artist who evolved. But that's only half correct. As was true in his 1950s cartoons, Seuss in his 1950s picture books was creating both racist and anti-racist work at the same time. And the racist images are gone now. I think many of us grew up believing, and I certainly grew up believing, that you're either on team racism or you're on team anti-racism. However, racism is not an either-or. It's a both-and. Starting in childhood, we absorb racist images and ideas without our awareness and without our consent. Seuss was unaware of how thoroughly his own imagination was steeped in a white supremacist culture. And if I'm honest with myself, neither am I. Another racist image coming. When preparing to teach this book in a grad class on 20th century picture books, I read Helen Bannerman's Little Black Sambo for the first time. And then I realized I already knew this story. So had I read her version? Had I read an edition with even more grotesque racist caricature? What other half-remembered stories lurk in my imagination, in my subconscious? Racist image is gone now. So anyway, a nagging sense of doubt that I'd not successfully grappled with Seuss and race in my earlier work was the genesis of Was the Cat in the Hat Black? Hidden Racism of Children's Literature and the Need for Diverse Books. The title chapter is a corrective to my earlier work on Seuss, and honestly, it'd be a better chapter if, in the book, I had explicitly done what I am doing now, which is acknowledging the flaws in my earlier work, because the first step in learning how to break up with your favorite racist children's books is being willing to admit that you were wrong. So let me tell you something else I was wrong about, something else I had to unlearn. And here's another racist image. My apologies for these. I tended to cut Dr. Seuss a bit of slack because, you know, he's a man of his time, right? That's what people thought back then, and the racist image is gone now. But think about that last sentence there. That's how people thought back then. Well, which people? All people everywhere? All white people? At all times, in any given place, all people did not think alike. And you can test this thesis right now. Do all people think alike in 2022? The "they thought that way then" claim presents past racism as inevitable, but racism is not inevitable. I learned this from Robin Bernstein, who I'll cite a lot in this talk. She reminds us that in the United States, and I'm quoting her here, the range of racial beliefs has changed relatively little from the 19th century to the present. The proportion of people who think particular thoughts has changed, but the, quote, array of thinkable thoughts has not. In the past and in the present, both ordinary and extraordinary people have opposed white supremacy. Both remarkable and unremarkable people have supported it. So in the same period that these six withdrawn Seuss books were published, they were withdrawn last March by Dr. Seuss Enterprises, in that same period we can find quite different portraits of people of African descent in the children's books of black writers like Langston Hughes and Audubon Thompson, and of white writers like Hildegard Hoyt Swift and Lynn Ward. When we are willing to admit that we are wrong, we might discover that what we thought to be true may at best be incomplete. As your own first step or second step, I don't know how far along in this process you are, but I invite you to listen to your own doubts about beloved works from your childhood. Books, films, video games, TV shows. And I invite you to begin or perhaps continue the process of reconsidering and of unlearning, which is another reason that I wrote Was the Cat in the Hat Black. I hope that the book might prompt reconsideration. Hope that it might even help persuade the unpersuaded, those who think that the problem of racism in children's literature has been solved, or who believe that what we read in childhood has little influence on our adult responses to prejudice. In the nearly 5 years since the book's initial publication, many reviews, comments, personal communications, and Dr. Seuss Enterprises' decision to stop publishing these six books with racist imagery indicate that my book is at least partly achieving that goal. But these days, I'm really much more interested in those who remain resistant or even hostile to these ideas. So if while you're listening to me, you sense any hostility in yourself, I want you to listen to that and reflect on why you might feel that way. And also know that it's okay to feel upset or angry. That can actually be part of the process of discovering why to break up with your favorite racist children's books and why it's in your best interest to do exactly that. So in the remainder of this talk, I'm going to do three things. First, I'll offer a brief overview of the book itself. And then second, drawing on the afterword to the paperback edition, which is published in 2019. We'll take a look at some of the hate mail that I received in order to better understand why people, and I think it's safe to say mostly white people, resist reflecting on racism. And we'll do this so that we can better educate them and better educate ourselves. And then third, we'll look at some of the barriers, the new barriers, such as education, new laws that regulate remembering promoted by manufactured hysteria about so-called cancel culture and by grotesque false caricatures of things like critical race theory and the 1619 Project. All right, so part one here. You might wonder, why is this my title? Why call this With the Cat in the Hat Black? Well, as Andy sort of gestured to at the beginning, Seuss really permeates American culture, and The Cat in the Hat's a great example of that. Created by Dr. Seuss 65 years ago, he stars in 6 books, 2 good animated cartoons, a Broadway musical, and 1 truly awful film. He's also in toys, on 2 U.S. postage stamps, was until very recently the mascot of the National Education Association's Read Across America, and he remains a corporate logo for Random House's beginner books. He's also at the center of the Dr. Seuss National Memorial in Springfield, Massachusetts. And as I noted earlier, Seuss does both racist and anti-racist work, and often at the same period in his career. 1940s cartoons are both racist against the Japanese and support civil rights for African Americans. The 1950s children's books include racist caricature, but also argue against discrimination. Horton Hears a Who, and the first version of the Sneetches, and the final version of that as well, and some racist images coming up here. The Cat in the Hat is somewhere in between those two extremes. He's certainly not overtly racist, but like lots of 20th century pop culture, think here of Bugs Bunny, Mickey Mouse, or even the Scarecrow from The Wizard of Oz, the cat bears the influence of blackface minstrelsy. And general lack of awareness of this fact is the ideal metaphor for how racism hides openly, indeed how it thrives in popular culture for young people. And that's why the title of the book is With the Cat in the Hat Black, even though only the first chapter actually focuses on Dr. Seuss. The Cat in the Hat illuminates the ways that images from the past, in this case blackface minstrelsy, continue to haunt the present, and that apparently discarded racial ideas linger on, influencing the broader culture and the next generation. Okay, racist images are gone now. And Seuss's career also reminds you that you don't need to be a Klansman or, Donald Trump to participate in white supremacy. Racist tropes often get transmitted unconsciously. So when Seuss created those racist images that I've showed you and other ones that I will show you, I don't actually think he was consciously trying to promote racism. In fact, I know he did not see himself as racist. But here's the thing. Racism does not depend upon self-perception or intent. That's why the title is a question. I really want people to reflect on what it might mean if racist ideas linger, whether covertly or overtly, in the children books we've grown up on and continue to read and to teach and care about. And, what should we do? What should we do with these books? Well, I know some of you have been talking about this in the chat, and you've been thinking about it. Here are a few possibilities. Classic books for young people transmit these racist tropes, so some people say, let's clean them up, right? Let's excise the racist bits so the books can still be enjoyed, right? Take out the racism, continue to read the books. And I see why people would make that suggestion, right? Because, you change the offensive portions, and that seems to offer a way to keep this available without inflicting harm on younger readers. Racist texts inflict real psychic damage on children of all races, but the child who is a member of the targeted group bears a heavier burden than the child who is not. So the racism in these books all but ensure that children are, and who have historically been, the targets of prejudice will suffer in ways that white children will not. And so that's one option. Or we could make the case, as Julius Lester and others have done, that the best way to hasten the decline of a racist classic, and thus the racism that it may propagate, is not to teach it at all, at any level. In fact, I think the biggest flaw in my book is that I do not lean more into the idea of simply not teaching damaging text. I do mention it as an option. I do quote Julius Lester. But when writing the book, I was really interested and much more interested in how we could use racist books to teach anti-racism. And that's a third choice, right, is to teach against the books. Because I was thinking that there's a risk involved in using the bowdlerized versions. And for those who might not know the term bowdlerized, it's to clean up an offensive text. The term comes from Thomas Bowdler, who did this to Shakespeare 200 years ago. So anyway, rather than do that, rather than bowdlerize, it struck me, and it still strikes me as a less risky choice, at least less risky than bowdlerizing, to teach the books critically and have painful but necessary conversations. And this is why. Just as characters like the Cat in the Hat or Mickey Mouse and Bugs Bunny naturalize or hide their minstrel origins, attempts to erase racism don't actually get rid of racist ideas. They just make them less obvious and thus more difficult to resist. So in the revised version of Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, the Oompa Loompas are now white. They're no longer African pygmies, but they still happily agree to being shipped to England in large packing cases, and they prefer life in a factory to life in their native land. They still submit to enslavement happily. Similarly, in Dr. Doolittle, removing references to skin color does not also remove colonialism. Dr. Doolittle remains an enlightened white European who goes to civilize the natives. The king of the Jolliginki may now be colorless, but he still lives in a palace made of mud in the jungle and is foolish enough to be duped by the bird Polynesia. So in all cases, trying to remove the racism and the colonialism really just more subtly encodes those same messages, the same racist and colonial messages. So I don't really think that cleaning up the books works. So in the book, I suggest that if you're going to read these books with children, then read the originals, but only do so in the context of other books that present racism and colonialism critically. So, for example, to expose the illusion of kindly white slave-owning Uncle Silas and the kind but gullible Jim in The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, readers might turn to realistic novels like Christopher Paul Curtis's Elijah of Buxton, where slavers are murderers and torturers, and where Canada, not America, is the land of the free. Or they might read To Be a Slave, a powerful collection of narratives by the formerly enslaved. There they learn of living quarters, quote, more fit for animals than human beings, end quote, mothers who killed their own children rather than allow them to be sold, and other ways that enslaved people resisted white slavers. In these books, unlike in Huckleberry Finn, slavery is not a joke. And a reason to take this approach is that, as Bridget Fielder noted, after I presented a version of this chapter at a conference, the decision to even talk about racism is a position of privilege. In other words, really only parents of white children have this choice. Since children of color face racism from their earliest days, the adults in their lives don't have the choice of whether to discuss racism with them or not. And discussing racism with them via the safer realm of children's books can prepare all children to face it in the world beyond the classroom. And if done carefully, rigorously, and uncomfortably, teaching racist children's books can even help direct the anger of those who are racism's targets. Because if, when facing racist art, children do not learn how to express anger, they may be left only with a pain they cannot articulate. And finding the appropriate target for one's anger is a vital survival skill. In the book, I was not, and I am not now, arguing for tough love. Suffering is not ennobling. Rather, I was, and I am, arguing that children understand more than they can articulate, and without the ability to name or to diagnose what they've experienced, they risk, in the words of Mari J. Matsuda, internalizing the injury done them and being rendered silent in the face of continuing injury. Which, of course, as I bet some of you are thinking right now, is also a reason not to teach books that injure, and why I should, in the book, lean more into what Julius Lester says, right? Just remove them all together, because all children should be granted a childhood free from the injuries of prejudice. Sure, literature can offer a safer space for young people to explore the difficult, deeply painful emotions that racism elicits, but does that safer space need to be in a discussion of books that perpetuate racism? What about just using those that examine racism critically? Which choice offers the most benefit and inflicts the least pain? And I imagine that as you think about these questions, and I can see that you are thinking about them in the chat, and that's great. You're probably also thinking about children's right to have an innocent childhood, because you want to protect children from pain and from cruelty. Because of course you do, we all do. So here's something else to consider as you mull this over, as Robin Bernstein demonstrates in her excellent book, Racial Innocence. The innocent child is always raised as white. Innocence is granted to white children and not to black children. For the entire history of this country, children of color have faced and still face standards of judgment that are much, much more severe than those faced by white children. Or to put this another way, white children are innocent until proven guilty, but young people of color are guilty until proven innocent, and often shot dead with no trial at all. According to a 2014 study of FBI data, police are 21 times more likely to shoot black teens than they are white teens. So, is it better to preserve children's literature as an innocent space for cultivating a child who feels loved, right, which is very, very important? Or is it better to use children's literature to prepare children for the hate they will face? How do we balance the need to protect against the imperative to educate? And as you think about that, know that innocence is also racialized in much more subtle ways, and that discussions about race and about racism can take place where, at first glance, racism doesn't even seem to be part of the work. It seems to be completely absent from the work. But the stories where race seems to disappear are often those where racism is actually more subtly and more dangerously embedded. And that insight, which I also gained from Robin, is why I wrote one chapter as a case study on William Joyce. And I don't know if you've seen the book or the film or the app of this, but the Fantastic Flying Books of Mr. Morris Lesmore is an aesthetic marvel. It's just beautiful. It's just a really beautiful, beautiful work. And when I was watching the animated version of the story, after having read Racial Innocence and while sitting next to Robin at a conference, I kept thinking about how the film is really, really white. That started to bother me. And then later, as I learned more about it, I found that its erasure of non-white people was even stranger, because Hurricane Katrina, which was the main inspiration for the story, killed nearly 2,000 people, and most of them were African Americans. But with the exception of a portrait of Duke Ellington, which you glimpse very briefly near the end, there are no characters of color in any version of the story. And that conspicuous absence in this story and in Joyce's body of work more generally highlights how structural racism works in children's literature. It tends to normalize whiteness, tends to dwell in nostalgia, and to exoticize, demonize, or erase non-white people. So the acclaim of Morris Lesmore, and it got a lot of acclaim, it depends in part upon the way it makes race disappear beneath whiteness's invisibility cloak. Unacknowledged whiteness is the midwife to all ostensibly transcendent, timeless stories. Culturally unmarked white characters read as universal characters. So despite the title character of this book's declaration that everyone's stories matter, the book doesn't agree with that. The absence of sympathetic characters of color in his work and in many other white creators' works, I could have written this chapter on anybody. It's really not specific to Joyce. But this absence perpetuates failures of the imagination. When children primarily consume culture that distorts or omits people like them, their psyches become damaged. The Nigerian-born contemporary novelist Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, whose TED Talk you may have seen, has spoken very eloquently of the effect that a childhood spent reading British and American children's books had on her. When she began writing her own stories at the age of 7, she tells us, "All my characters were white and blue-eyed. They played in the snow, they ate apples, and they talked a lot about the weather, how lovely it was that the sun had come out." Now this, despite the fact that I lived in Nigeria, I had never been outside Nigeria. We didn't have snow. We ate mangoes, and we didn't talk about the weather because there was no need to. As she says, her young experience shows, quote, how impressionable and vulnerable we are in the face of the story, particularly as children. Because all I had read were books in which characters were foreign, I had become convinced that books by their very nature had to have foreigners in them and had to be about things with which I could not personally identify. That's the end of that quote. And then she says, one more quote here, "One unintended consequence was that I did not know that people like me could exist in literature." And whether we call this process the danger of a single story or colonizing the imagination, it demonstrates that racial invisibility is as harmful as racial stereotyping. So I'm going to imagine that the educators out here, whether that's your profession or your role as a caregiver for a child, I'm going to imagine that you do diversify what you share with the young people in your lives. And just to be clear here, all children need diverse books. Minoritized children need to see themselves, and white children need to know that they are not the center of the universe. But let me ask you, what percentage of the books that you share are by creators of color? One fourth? One half? Three fourths? In other words, you know, could you be doing better than you are now doing? And I ask that because we all need to work to decolonize our imaginations. From the first time I taught literature for children at the university level, I've included diverse voices on my syllabus. But Professor Ebony Elizabeth Thomas, who gave a great talk via these seminars last year, she taught me how I could do more and do better. When I was going to teach multicultural children's literature for the first time, I asked if she'd be willing to share a syllabus for a multicultural children's literature class. She replied that she teaches her children's literature class as a multicultural children's literature class, and she kindly shared her syllabus. And then a light bulb went off, just like in the cartoons. Why am I not also teaching my children's literature class in that same way? Why not center multicultural children's books instead of merely including them? And so that's what I do now, thanks to Ebony. All right, an extremely brief as in 90 seconds total summary of the remaining couple of chapters, and then we will get to my hate mail, since I'm sure you're wondering about that. Believing that books with a person of color on the cover won't sell, publishers will put a white face or silhouette or ambiguously race face on the dust jacket of a book whose protagonist is not white, but of course this is important because we do judge books by their color, by their covers, and those that render people of color invisible tell them that their lives and their experiences are not important enough to read about. And young readers notice. They also notice the kinds of stories that are available to them. Though over half of U.S. public school-age students are children of color, only 25% of American children's books published in 2017 were about people of color, and the number by people of color was only 15%. That number has improved in the past few years, but there's still a huge representation deficit. If you look more closely, you'll notice something else. You'll notice that realism, historical novels, and nonfiction are by far the most popular genre categories. So where 50 years ago, people of color were almost entirely excluded from mainstream publishing, now they can publish, but really only in a few neighborhoods, the borders of which can be mapped by genre. And as the YA novelist Melinda Lowe notes that there can be a zillion white authors who write whatever kind of book, but if one marginalized author exists who does it, that's enough. And because I wanted to not just describe a problem, but tell people how they might solve it, and the conclusion, there's a manifesto for anti-racist children's literature. So for instance, recognize that personal racism is often unconscious, and systemic racism can be invisible, or white people should use their unearned privileges to fight white supremacy. Indeed, all white people are beneficiaries of white supremacy, whether we want to be or not, so we have a moral obligation to use that unearned power, the power conferred upon us by whiteness, to fight white supremacy. Incidentally, Rick Riordan, the author of the popular Percy Jackson series, is a super example of a white person who's done this. He's used his Disney Hyperion imprint to sign and publish some fantastic books by writers of color, so I recommend those books to you, and I recommend his example as well. Okay, in the resources, I placed a handout with the manifesto's main points, so you can get those there if you like, and I'm happy to address those in greater detail at any time you'd like. But now, let's get to part two here, why adults refuse to admit racist content in the children's books they love and what we can do about it. So I thought I wrote a fairly cogently argued book and even offered some suggestions for addressing racism in children's literature and culture. So problem solved. No, actually. 400 years of white supremacist thinking and laws and culture are not going to be undone by a small book. In fact, I received a fair quantity of hate mail, and people were so generous with their comments that I thought that I would do something with their generosity. I mean, if you want to understand why adults refuse to admit the racist content in children's books that they love, is there a better place to start than your hate mail? I'm very broadly classifying hate mail as responses from social media, personal email, reviews on Amazon that are obviously just there to shout at you, comments on my toxic Google YouTube video, and on media stories of three kinds. My book itself, Cambridge, Massachusetts school librarian Liz Phipps-Sierra, who cited my book in her rejection of a gift of Dr. Seuss books from Melania Trump. Sierra was protesting the Trump administration's education policies, and the decision of children's book creators Lisa Yee, Mike Carrado, and Mo Willems not to appear at the Seuss Museum in protest of its reproduction in the museum entrance of the racist Chinaman caricature from Seuss's And to Think That I Saw It on Mulberry Street. And you saw that that earlier in this talk. I have to give some credit here to the inspiration for reading the hate mail, and that is the fifth chapter of Gloria Wecker's White Innocent, which reads the 1,500 emails protesting a 2008 Van Abbey Museum Modern Art exhibit, and there's a racist image coming up here. The exhibit critically examined the phenomenon of Zwarte Piet, who is Black Piet, the racist caricature in Dutch lore who assists Santa Claus. Okay, that racist image is gone now. So a quick tour through eight strategies of mostly white denial and reflection, followed by some suggestions on how we might respond to those who resist the reflection and introspection that successful anti-racist education requires. So defending white children's innocence is one theme. The very possibility of racism in the work of a beloved children's author is perceived as an attack on innocence itself. Defenders of Seuss's work cite, Defenders of Seuss's work cite white children's purported innocence, aligning it with a kind of natural anti-racism based in children's alleged inability to see color, or to see race, or to see racism, ignoring the documented fact that children as young as two already know what skin color they have. Oh, and I see this quote is not showing up there. But anyway, there it is. Perfect. What skin color they have and which advantages being white confers. And these defenses, both innocents and children, are always imagined as white, although the commenters never identify them as that. The invisibility of whiteness to white people is, as Wecker says, quote, a white delusion. There is, of course, speaking about race means you are the racist, and if any of you have done this sort of education, I'm sure you've heard this one before. To borrow the words of one commenter, quote, every time you open your mouths and accuse someone of being racist, you are the ones who are racist, not the other way around. You think about that. This claim rests on a belief in colorblindness, a racial colorblindness, which is a well-intentioned lie promoted in U.S. public schools that is the source of such nonsensical claims as, I don't see race. Though, of course, the very laudable notion here is not to judge someone based on race. The effect is the denial of both race and racism. There is imagining racism in everything. That's a good one. To quote a comment on a USA Today article, quote, Dr. Seuss books and many other innocuous things are only racist in the eyes of those who wear the beer goggles of racism and see racism in everything. I like that metaphor. This claim overlooks the fact that racism is structural. And so, yeah, racism is everywhere. White people often deny this fact because white supremacy is not only less visible to its beneficiaries, but also really uncomfortable to acknowledge. It upsets whites' belief in meritocracy, confronting us with the fact that we benefit from the oppression of others. There were lots of people that said I didn't know what I was talking about. One asked, has this Dalton professor read the Sneetches by Dr. Seuss? He should before he made his comments. A related criticism is the a cat is a cat argument, which rests in the belief that children's literature cannot be studied or children's books are to be taken literally. Because, of course, to claim that a cat in the hat is a cat is, well, unusual, right? I mean, how many cats walk upright or have adult human height, wear top hats, carry umbrellas, can juggle and speak in verse? I'm going to guess very few. Maybe only this one. There's proximity to blackness, which is the belief that real or imagined proximity to blackness somehow cleanses a cultural artifact of any racist content. And many commenters cite the fact that participating in the National Education Association's Read Across America Day, which used to use the Cat in the Hat as its mascot, Barack and Michelle Obama read Dr. Seuss books. So therefore, these commenters conclude the Seuss books consequently could not possibly harbor even the residue of racism. There's lots of just plain angry displays of racism and sexism and transphobia, and I don't really think this subset of commenters can be persuaded by reasoned argument. So let's move on to the othering of the critic, which is another strategy of denial. But it wasn't quite the same for me as it was for Gloria Wecker. As an Afro-Surinamese Dutch scholar, she faced xenophobia, racism, and sexism directed at her personhood. But it's impossible to mobilize that kind of dehumanization against this, right? Straight, white, cisgendered, American-born male. So commenters had to find milder ways to other me. There were variants on the notion of the out-of-touch academic, performing useless labor. Other critics decided I must be motivated by a desire for publicity or maybe for financial gain. Some diagnosed me as mentally ill, and several claimed that I clearly had no sense of humor. Wecker described the experience of reading those emails about Zwarte Piet, about Black Piet, as, quote, like taking an undiluted dose of poison. In contrast, reading my hate mail was not an attack on my basic humanity in the same way. The armor of white, male, straight, cisgendered privilege shielded me from the worst of it. And this armor is a key reason why whites or members, any members of majority culture need to do anti-racist work. You can't dehumanize us in the same way. So it's up to us to speak up. This was the most popular response, that the left and political correctness and Democrats are responsible for, you know, everything that's going wrong. As one comment said, this hit piece on the Cat in the Hat appears to have emerged from the dark cult of the radical left. Another commenter said that this sort of lunatic liberal overreach led to the election of Donald Trump. Those who cite opposing racism in children's literature as aiding Trump's election confuse symptom with cause, but they actually do highlight the very real connection between childhood nostalgia and racism, and that's where I want to go next as we think about ways that we might respond. There are different types of nostalgia. What Svetlana Boym calls restorative nostalgia motivates both supporters of Mr. Trump and those who ask that we not look too closely at beloved children's books. Restorative nostalgia wishes to revive a true tradition that takes itself seriously, and it seeks to construct a vision of a unified, uncomplicated past. As she says, it expresses a longing for an enchanted world with clear borders and values, but as she warns, only false memories can be totally recalled. Restorative nostalgia emerges as a response to feelings of fear and uncertainty. In times of social upheaval, nostalgic outbreaks like these become more frequent. Anxiety about perceived disorder or social change can be redirected to the imaginary balm of this mode of nostalgia. And as you are probably already thinking as I'm saying this, this is really dangerous. Restorative nostalgia, whether for an imaginary era when America was great or when childhood was innocent, fuels totalitarian thinking. So that's why I think we want to transform the one kind of nostalgia, restorative nostalgia, into reflective nostalgia, which, in contrast, dwells in memories, imperfections, and it explores the ambivalence and the complexity that restorative nostalgia strives to erase. Because it's not bad in and of itself, right? It's to what end that longing goes. And children's books and children's culture are the ideal location for this work, because nostalgia is not a longing for a place, as the term's creator, 17th century Swiss medical student Johannes Hofer, thought it was. Instead, nostalgia is a longing for childhood. It's a longing for time. And in the case of restorative nostalgia, It's a longing for an idealized version of childhood, one that forgets trauma, forgets sadness, forgets pain. And via this sort of selective amnesia, restorative nostalgia, in Boehm's words here, projects personal affective memories onto the larger historical picture in an attempt to make sense of the chaotic present. So, all right, so we need to transform nostalgia. How can we do that, you ask? Well, I think one way we can move restorative nostalgia towards reflective nostalgia is to show the damage that is done by restorative nostalgia, because restorative nostalgia doesn't heal your wounds. It just relocates them. And as Boehm warns us, restorative nostalgia is really dangerous because in confusing the real home with an imagined one, it can create a phantom homeland for the sake of which one is ready to die or kill. And I'm quoting her here. She says, unreflective nostalgia can breed monsters. So we have to show people the deeply felt memories. And I recognize these are deeply felt memories and beloved memories. But they don't authorize indifference toward others. Nor do they remove the need for reflection. We must ask, what would it mean to admit that what we loved as children could hurt someone today? What would it mean to admit that it hurt someone then? What would it mean to acknowledge pain? And I think this is the second thing that we need to do. I think we need to acknowledge pain. It's why I asked you earlier in the talk to listen to your own emotional responses, because quite possibly some of you listening feel upset. More angry at the notion that a childhood favorite or a classic work of literature harbors racist ideas. I arrive at this insight in part via James Baldwin, who very wisely observed, I imagine one of the reasons people cling to their hate so stubbornly is because they sense, once hate is gone, they will be forced to deal with pain. So that's one reason I think pain is the key. The force with which commenters blame me, or liberals, or academics, or people of color, or women, is one way of locating responsibility for their own pain and other people, and avoiding looking inward. I also arrive at this insight via my relationship with my own father. In June 2015, when I was writing the book, an armed white supremacist murdered 9 worshipers at Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church in Charleston, South Carolina, which is a city that I lived in for 2 years. And on his jacket, the white supremacist wore the flag of apartheid-era South Africa. And that's the country where my parents and their parents grew up and where many of my relatives still live. So I wrote on my blog of the need to confront the racism in one's own family, and I began like this. I come from a long line of Southern racists. My predecessors come not from the American South, but from the African South, specifically South Africa. An uncle of mine ran for office under the auspices of an Afrikaner white supremacist political party. He lost. One grandfather insisted that American blacks were essentially a different species than African blacks. My father believes the canard that Barack Obama's presidency is illegitimate because the president was born not in Hawaii, as his birth certificate indicates, but in Kenya. And in the post, I also spoke of how we can both love and disagree with our racist relatives. I don't think my father was able to hear the love part of that. Indeed, and this will not surprise you, a public blog post may not be the best way to confront your racist relatives. What activist Loretta J. Ross proposes would have been a better approach. As a critique of call-out culture, she advocates call-in culture, in which you invite someone into a conversation. As she puts it, when you think somebody has done something wrong and you want to hold them accountable, you don't react with anger or with hate. You just remain calm and look at them and say, that's an interesting viewpoint. Tell me more. In other words, you listen generously and then you press someone on why precisely they believe what they do and then only offer counterexamples. That's going to have a higher success rate, and I recommend her TED Talk and the TED Radio Hour in which she's featured if you'd like to learn more about that. In the case of my father, I actually don't think that would have worked. I think it would have been better, but I don't think it would have worked. But it might work with your own relatives or other people you know. Though he has in the past been capable of considerable generosity, you know, the the photo that you see here, he built that. That's a bed with a desk beneath it. He built that himself for me when I was a child. And there are countless examples of generosity of his that I could cite. So he has been capable of that, but that capacity has withered as he's embraced conspiracy theories and the circle of his paranoia has expanded. Indeed, subsequent correspondence revealed him to be both far, far more racist than I had thought, and also someone who, of course, insisted that he was not racist. So to try to restore peace, I took down the blog post, even though it actually was something of an understatement, and I apologized. He did not. He did stop speaking to me. And though I initially felt hurt by that choice, I came to welcome the extraordinary gift of his silence. That silence and the conclusion of our relationship created the necessary space for reflection. You see, we all carry within us complex histories of pain. And if we fail to name that pain and reckon with that history, we risk damaging others because we're not aware of our own histories of pain continue to shape us. My father's father was abusive, though he would have seen it as discipline and not abuse. But abuse from a caregiver violates the trust upon which we build our capacity to love. So in my father's case, I think receiving pain instead of care begat a defensive paranoia that has made him highly receptive to conspiracy theories, like, you know, white supremacy. Unable to see how his own soul has been injured, he locates the injury in a world that is, and he believes has always been, hostile to him. And that's why Baldwin's insight resonated so strongly with me. I imagine one of the reasons people cling to their hate so stubbornly is because they sense once hate is gone, they will be forced to deal with pain. That quotation works very well for thinking about racism, which is why I quoted it. But in that quotation, Baldwin is actually describing his relationship with his own father. But he could be describing my relationship with mine. So as you may have guessed, my father's racism and my family history, and there's another racist image coming up here, there's a racist doll in this picture, and me, this motivates my own anti-racism and my willingness to read and analyze my hate mail. The projection in that hate mail, the anger, especially the anger, have a familiar, even familial flavor to it. And I'd really like to learn from it. I want to transform the hatred into something useful, ideally by helping myself and others become better educators. So why is that? Why is it that considering racist content in the works of our youth can feel like a personal attack? Well, I think first, children's books are signposts not just to our childhoods, but to the formation of ourselves. And really, that's true of a lot of children's culture. So when you examine them closely, that can feel akin to a violation, because they reside deep at the core of the me that we each have within us. And then second, children's books evoke what is both cherished and lost, a combination that, as Walter Benjamin noted in 1929, has the potential to make us reactionary. As he says, whatever one reads or plays during one's childhood is remembered not only as the most beautiful and the best, but often, and quite incorrectly, as unique. In thinking about these objects, everyone becomes a reactionary. So for that reason, the memories evoked by childhood books and toys are very likely to arouse fierce protectiveness, in fact, more likely than they are to inspire reflection. And then third, the other reason that people respond so with such intense emotion and often anger is that children's books imaginatively fulfill the nostalgist's longing to travel back in time. Children's books seem to transport readers to their childhoods. And I think here of Vladimir Nabokov's description of the strongly nostalgic pull of revisiting favorite children's books. He says, I see again my schoolroom in Vera, the blue roses of the wallpaper, the open window. And he talks about a sense of security, of well-being, of summer warmth pervading his memory. And he says, that robust reality makes a ghost of the present. The mirror brims with brightness. A bumblebee has entered the room against the ceiling. Everything is as it should be. Nothing will change. Nobody will die. Now, Nabokov's tone conveys a self-awareness, conveys a willingness to reflect that restorative nostalgists, and I think my critics, typically lack. So when somebody like me points out the racism and you know, Dr. Seuss or Roald Dahl or Mark Twain or Lynn Ree Banks, such readers can feel that we are ambushing their childhood memories. And that leads me to my final suggestion on how to help persuade people, and that is to admit nuance. I think that can help diminish the feeling of being ambushed. So I think one reason for the angry comments and the hate mail is that people didn't actually read the book. They read the headlines. Now, in chapter one, I say that the Cat in the Hat bears the influence of blackface minstrelsy, as do lots of icons of children's literature. It's not, you know, it's not unique in that respect. But I do not say that the Cat in the Hat is racist, and racist caricature coming up again. I will say now, and I should have said in chapter one, that I do think that how his body re-encodes racist caricature unconsciously prepares imaginations to accept more overt versions of that caricature. So in this sense, the cat is an unwitting participant in white supremacy. But of course, racism thrives through the unknowing reproduction of its imagery and ideas. Racism is the weed that, disguising itself as a flower, gradually infiltrates and becomes indistinguishable from them, from the garden. It then thrives by blending in with the other plants. Nuanced reading, and I'm going to take nuanced reading makes everyday racism visible, and it can help people, especially white people, understand structural racism by showing that, for instance, white supremacist imagery ranges from obviously racist caricature to far more subtle forms. So like Little Black Sambo, this is the African style Island of Yerka, Black Pete, quite obvious ones. But then there are also less obvious ones, the whitened Oompa Loompas, who in the revised version of Dahl's novel still happily submit to enslavement, and the Cat in the Hat himself. And if we want to educate the skeptics, I think the distinction between degrees of complicity is necessary. The racist images are gone again, and headlines that proclaim the racism of the Cat in the Hat reduce a complex question to clickbait, causing people to reject the argument before they've had a chance to consider it. And I have one more part here. I hope I haven't had any interruptions from Anne yet, so, or at least I haven't seen them, so I hope this is all going smoothly.
Absolutely.
And I hope I haven't... It's going okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, just making sure. As I'm sure many of you know out there, when you give these presentations, you see no one, and you imagine how people respond, and I'm getting a glimpse of things in the comments, but who knows? Talking into the void. That has been life for the last couple of years, hasn't it? Okay, well, this is the last section, and it's the shortest one. It is coming up here. There it is. So I wrote with the Cat in the Hat Black during a period of racial optimism in America, the Obama era. During the page proof phase, I had to actually rewrite the section of the manifesto that says, support a U.S. Anti-Racism Education Act because racism is a national emergency that threatens our democracy. In its draft form, I wrote about having narrowly avoided the dangers of President Trump, but how his presidential campaign had made plain that pandering to racists can nearly propel a sociopathic con artist to the presidency. And so, just as we passed the National Defense Education Act in 1958, we needed an Anti-Racism Act in 2017. Those recommendations remain in the book, although, of course, I revised to accurately reflect the outcome of the election. The book was published in the summer of 2017, by which time a resurgent white supremacy had ended America's second Reconstruction. Voting Rights Act of 1965, got it in 2013, a major political party openly embracing its white supremacist leader, and of course, civil rights, human rights, multicultural education, all under attack. Today, that attack continues via the rise of memory laws, the myth of cancel culture, and the demonization of serious education about race or racism. So the situation is much more dire for anti-racist education, and for the survival of American democracy itself. So what I'd like to do in my final minutes here is talk about how the two of these, anti-racism and democracy, are connected. We need anti-racism for democracy to prevail, and we need democracy for anti-racism to prevail. And of particular importance to me as an educator is the two key battlegrounds for anti-racism and democracy are our public education system in particular, and children's literature and children's culture more generally. So in the public education system, addressing the centrality of racism in U.S. history is increasingly against the law. Deliberate misrepresentation of critical race theory and of Nicole Hannah-Jones' 1619 project serve as pretexts, really as scapegoats, for these new laws. In fact, some of the new laws mention one or both of these by name. So in case this needs saying, critical race theory, which originates in American legal discourse in the 1970s, or really arguably the late 1970s, it helps us see how racism is not just personal, but also structural, embedded in culture and in institutions. That's what it is. So to give you an example, you are now listening to a talk that is strongly influenced by critical race theory. The current lies about critical race theory originate with conservative activist Christopher Rufo, who has deliberately fashioned critical race theory as a scapegoat. To quote Rufo himself on his invention, quote, critical race theory is the perfect villain because its connotations are all negative to most middle-class Americans. Strung together, the phrase critical race theory connotes hostile, academic, divisive, race-obsessed, poisonous, elitist, anti-American, end quote. So that's quite clever, right? I mean, he takes a pre-existing term, distorts it, fashions it into a perfect villain. Very helpful for frightening people, getting them to mobilize against evils that do not in fact exist. So citing lies about critical race theory, state legislatures and school boards are passing what Yale professor and authoritarianism expert Timothy Snyder identifies as memory laws. Quote, government actions designed to guide public interpretation of the past. Such measures work by asserting a mandatory view of historical events, by forbidding the discussion of historical facts or interpretations, or by providing vague guidelines that lead to self-censorship. And as of right now, a dozen state legislatures have passed laws forbidding educators from telling the truth about the history of U.S. racism. And all of these laws, all of them, were passed in 2021 and 2022. Most specifically ban what they call critical race theory, even though it's not taught in primary or secondary school. It's most often encountered in graduate school. That's where I encountered it. So to give you just one example, there's an Iowa law that prohibits educators from teaching or addressing any questions about these concepts, and I quote, that any individual should feel discomfort, guilt, anguish, or any other form of psychological distress on account of that individual's race or sex. To insist that education never caused discomfort is to insist that educators lie. And learning about America's founding crimes, genocide, slavery, should really make us uncomfortable. Genocide and slavery are crimes against humanity. If we don't feel uncomfortable learning about that, the lesson has gone very, very wrong. But the genius of this bill, and these bills are quite clever, I mean, I really want to give them credit for that, is that its rhetoric is presented in the guise of supporting diversity, equity, and inclusion. So it's a real masterpiece of doublespeak. Contemporary American memory laws explicitly target multicultural education. State governments turn the intent of multicultural education upside down, transforming the powerful into a group that requires protection. In fact, that's also what they're doing with memory laws, which emerge actually in Europe to insist that people tell the truth about the Holocaust, right? They emerge to protect a minoritized group from the lies of Holocaust deniers. And so the American memory laws flip that, right? They're trying to protect not a vulnerable group, but a powerful group from feeling any responsibility for the racism from which they benefit. But anyway, as I say, the Iowa law is not an isolated case. Arizona, Georgia, Idaho, New Hampshire, North Dakota, Oklahoma, South Carolina, Tennessee, Texas have all passed similar laws, and Florida's Department of Education has approved guidelines that do the same thing. There are active bills in about 10 other state legislatures. The second related problem is hysteria about so-called cancel culture, which serves the same function. In an effort to censor anti-racist critiques of culture, cancel culture hysterics describe anti-racism as censorship. To attack the freedom to fight oppression, they claim that withdrawing racist children's books is somehow an assault on freedom, which is more doublespeak. Because, you know, is it possible to cancel a culture? Sure, it's possible. There were once more than 300 indigenous languages spoken in the U.S. About half of those languages remain. Colonization, genocide, residential schools, forced assimilation have all been really effective at canceling cultures. In fact, forbidding a careful, critical look at U.S. history is also quite an effective approach. But the cancel culture that animates professional grievance actors today refers to culture under no threat of cancellation. Mr. Potato Head, Dr. Seuss books, Muppets. Because it's really hard to cancel a dominant culture. Which is why I say that cancel culture is a white supremacist fantasy that creates villains and then mobilizes anger against the villains that it has imagined. And this is how anti-racism, democracy, and childhood are all connected. The lie of cancel culture depends upon nostalgia for childhood. In that Benjamin quote I showed you, right? Children's culture evokes what is both cherished and lost, and that combination has the potential to make us reactionary. So it's super easy to inspire a reactionary response when you point out racism in a beloved artifact of childhood or a cherished misunderstanding of American history. So I understand why people would want to defend the myths to make America great again. That nostalgia for a past that never was, that longing for the better American future we were promised, it's really deeply ingrained. I grew up with this too. Facing the truth and the legacy of America's founding crimes is painful, but it's also necessary. And so that's why we have to break these memory laws. We have to teach multicultural children's books and recommend books that present American history in its messy, contentious complexity. This does not require all students to agree on what U.S. history means. It requires that they grapple with the problems of understanding it. I mean, if we can't talk about racism in our schools, if we can't correct our favorite racist misunderstandings, and if we can't experience the discomfort of doing this, it's going to be a lot harder to discuss why we might want to break up with our favorite racist children's books. And in conclusion, I'll offer you one final personal example, which is what I learned. I learned that Dr. Seuss Enterprises was withdrawing these six books. My friend, Professor Sarah Park Dolan, texted me, and I thought, all right, I know that these three are going to be included for their racist caricatures, and they were, but I was really surprised to see Ambiance Zebra on the list, because that book is a personal favorite. It invents an entirely new alphabet to describe all you can see if you don't stop at the letter Z. It reminds young readers that this difficult language they're learning to read right now in school, it's kind of arbitrary, slightly ridiculous. Right? Why not have a totally different alphabet? So what could be objectionable about this? Well, racist image coming here. In rereading, I realized that the book's caricature of a Middle Eastern man was a caricature of a Middle Eastern man. I had not seen the illustration as a caricature until then. And I've written a lot about Seuss and about racism in his work. I mean, of all people, you'd think I would have noticed, but I hadn't. I didn't know what I didn't know. I didn't see what I didn't see. Racist image gone again. When you grow up in a racist culture, you won't see all the racism. It's just a part of the world in which you live. If you've only ever seen a polluted ocean, then that's what an ocean looks like. Only when someone points out the pollution in the ocean or the racism in the culture do you notice. And you begin to ask questions. And I hope this talk has inspired you to ask questions, and I can see that it has. Of yourselves, of your education, of schools today, and of me. My own anti-racist education is and will always be very much a work in progress. The structures of power, white supremacy, patriarchy, heterosexism, and so on, all those structures that have eased my path through life also obscure my awareness of how they work. Unearned power remains invisible to its beneficiaries. But when you are on the receiving end of power, you feel it and you see it. It's much harder to ignore. So when I make mistakes, and I do make mistakes, I listen to critiques of my efforts from Black, Indigenous, and people of color. I learn, I apologize, and I strive to do better. As James Baldwin wrote of white people, of which I am one, they are, in effect, still trapped in a history which they do not understand, and until they understand it, they cannot be released from it. And as he also wrote, I am what time, circumstance, history have made of me, certainly, but I am also much more than that. So are we all. Yeah, so are we all, and that should inspire us all to do better. Thanks, everybody, for your attention and for your questions. Maybe we can get to some of those now. Thank you.
Fantastic, Professor. Thank you so much for leading us through that narrative, and in particular being vulnerable with your first person sort of description of what we've done. We do have some questions that have queued up, and I'm going to remind our audience to use the Ask Professor Nell tab to submit formal questions that I can bring forward as the moderator. I suspect there were some questions in the chat box that scrolled out of my view, and I don't want to go back and try to sort of parse those together. So if you do have something you'd like us to address, drop it into the chat, to the Ask the Professor tab. This first question comes from Robert. Robert is a teacher at the Bank Street School in New York City. It's a little longer. I'm going to read it. Professor, you can also read along with me if you like. It's in the middle bottom of your screen. It's question 17. Robert asks the following. You spoke tonight about how racist images and specific titles have been purged from the Seuss catalog. However, despite the unconscious, these are the words you shared, racist connections of the Cat in the Hat, the Cat in the Hat's form, inspired by images from ministry, still persists, as you mentioned. I'm curious about your thoughts on our collective engagement with even more ubiquitous symbols, even if and especially if they've evolved in our illustrations, things like Mickey Mouse, for example, whose historical roots, despite the brand's best efforts, just can't be erased.
Yeah, that's a fantastic question, because it speaks to how so deeply ingrained and thoroughly woven racist images and ideas are in our culture, and how unweaving that or purging us of that is not easy, and is an ongoing struggle. And that's actually how I think of it, because you say, you know, what should we do about that? A book that I found really helpful in my own thinking, and they focus more on language than on images, but is Karen Fields and Barbara Fields' Racecraft. And they used racecraft to talk about the way language embeds racist ideas. So, for example, people talk of racial profiling. They say, you know, as if somehow this inheres in the person being profiled. It's racial profiling, but it's not. It's really racist profiling. The profiler is the one. But that language kind of does a little linguistic sleight of hand there that suggests the problem isn't the person being profiled. And that permeates the language just as those images permeate the culture. And I don't have a quick fix, and not that you're asking for that, I know you're not asking for that, but I don't have an easy solution apart from being open to interrogate, to challenge ourselves and others about these things, and to have those uncomfortable conversations. I mean, I wish I could just say, well, you know, here's the answer, but it is so ingrained in our culture that it is everywhere. And so that's one thing that they're right about, you know, that people tell me, hey, see racism and everything. Well, yeah. because it is. So, but that's a wonderful question, and it shows you to be a careful and thinker and very thoughtful. And I really like the question. I wish I had a better answer.
Yeah, thank you. This next question comes from Allison, who is located just outside of Salt Lake City, Utah. And Allie's wondering if Dr. Seuss himself was ever approached or asked to discuss this particular perspective. Was he ever, I don't want to say confronted, but rather was he asked to sort of reflect on this while he was with us?
Seuss was challenged about some of the things in his work while he was with us. The one that connects to race that he was challenged on was The Chinaman, and I think that I saw it in Mulberry Street. The original editions feature a yellow Chinaman, that's what he's called, carrying chopsticks and with a pigtail. And when this was pointed out to Seuss in the 1970s, he changed the illustration. He cut off the pigtail and removed the yellow color from Chinese man. He became a Chinese man. Now, he still has slanty eyes. You know, he's still running along with chopsticks. So, you know, he's like, I don't know, 50% less racist. So that's something. But I should also say that Seuss's response to that was kind of snarky. you know, he said, you know, people complained about the Chinaman. So, you know, I cut off his pigtails and removed the color, and now it looks like an Irishman, he says. And, like, that's not helpful, right? Seuss was very resistant when people asked him to change stuff in his work. He did change a few things, but he was very resistant and often quite snarky about it. That's the one thing he was challenged on, was that. The rest of it, no. And again, I don't think he was aware how much his own imagination was steeped in the white supremacist culture he grew up in. You know, one where blackface minstrelsy was an entertainment, one where, when he was a child, The Birth of a Nation was the top grossing film in the United States. So that would be my longer answer. But yeah, that's the one time was the Chinaman example. And his response to that was, at best, mixed.
Mm. Right.
I wish I could say better, but I can't, because it wasn't.
This question comes from Brian, who is an art teacher in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. And he's wondering, you know, we talked a lot tonight about primarily a domestic context. What are, in your experience, how have other cultures, countries, schools, education systems dealt with this same issue with Dr. Seuss?
Ah, I love that as a question. So I don't know that I can address other cultures and Dr. Seuss so much, because Seuss is very much a North American phenomenon. Well, all right. He's popular in North America, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand, less in England, and the rest of the world, not really as much. He's not as ubiquitous. But I have been really interested in how other cultures address systemic racism in their own culture and in their own children's culture. And I've actually just recently written a piece on Germany, which is fantastic at addressing the legacy of the Holocaust, but not so good at addressing the legacy of colonialism. And it's, I don't know if I have a succinct answer to this, but I mean, I guess I would say that that's a good question, because it's not a problem unique to the United States. It is a problem that cultures all over the world have, and they all struggle with it in different ways, or don't struggle with it well in different ways. Germany's racism is also very much entangled in America's racism, because they learned some of it from us, you know, after the Second World War. They were both sort of educated about, you know, racism being bad, but then also saw, you know, how black GIs were treated versus white GIs, and so they're learning from us some of our own racism. So it's complicated. But in terms of addressing Dr. Seuss in particular, I don't have an answer. I have been thinking about how other cultures address racism in children's literature, notably Germany and coming up soon Denmark. And I will just say that they struggle in parallel ways to us, although not using always the same language and with different national understandings about the importance of difference. Maybe that's the thing to conclude on, that the American notion of a society being inherently heterogeneous, inherently diverse, is not a notion held by a German society, where you're taught to respect the difference in people from other countries, less the difference within your own country. And of course, both of those ideas themselves are complex, right? Yeah. I mean, we say we value multiculturalism in this country, but the whole racist history of this country contradicts that. But anyway, I'll stop there, because that's too long of an answer, and I think I'm losing the audience, if not myself. So, yes.
But one more quick question. This one comes from John, who is in Jupiter, Florida, just north of Miami. He's wondering if you can think of any other examples of an author, let's stay with authors in this context, who, like Dr. Seuss, we sort of learned about and became aware of the racism in the work that then we sort of moved away from and now are not a part of our typical sort of cultural reference points. An example I noticed in the chat box is one of our attendees mentioned, I think it was Lisa mentioned, that she did not know who Sambo was. So
oh, that's great.
Is there a point where generationally we can just sort of, that there have been examples of other authors like this or pieces of work that just sort of leave the generations?
I mean, I would love for this to be consigned to history, but there are so many racist books in print right now that, you know, I mean, why are the Indian in the Cupboard books still being published? Mm-hmm. For example, Lynn Reed Banks' series, or the Skippy John Jones books with their, you know, Spanglish dialect. There's so much out there that's still in print that's contemporary. I would love for this to some way be consigned to the historical section of the library, you know, research only, but it doesn't seem likely, especially today, frankly. It doesn't seem likely. I mean, we are living in a moment of, you know, resurgent white supremacy, the likes of which I think many of us thought was on the wane. I like the optimism of the question. I like the hopefulness of the question. I don't imagine a day when this is not going to be something we're wrestling with, but I also want us to work for that day, you know. So that's why I like the optimism of the question. We have to work for the better future, knowing that we may not see those results in our lifetimes. We have to still work for that, and that's really important to remember right now, as things seem to be going in a very dark and dangerous direction. So hang on to that hope, and then use that hope to act, because all hope is rooted in action. And I'll end with that little invitation to transform hope into action and to create that world that the question hopes for.
Professor Phil Nell, thank you so much for leading tonight's conversation. We appreciate your insights, and we appreciate the way you've walked us through this complicated topic. Thank you.
Thanks for having me. Thanks, everybody, for coming, too. I hope it was useful.
And I want to thank all of our audience for joining us tonight and encourage you to follow the National Humanities Center on our social media feeds to get notices of upcoming events and activities. That includes our next webinar, which is two nights from now. This is a doubleheader week. We're inviting and we'll be having discussion with Jacoby Williams, who is a past fellow at the center and currently a professor of African American Studies at Indiana University, to share his work titled Global Call of Power to the People and the Influence of Malcolm X on a Global Context. I hope to see you on Thursday night, if not at a future webinar in the series. Thank you again for all of the work that you're doing. Have a great day at school tomorrow. We'll see you next time in the Humanities in Class webinar series. Good night, everyone.
You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch. You really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus. You're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch. You're a bad banana with a greasy black peel. You're a monster, Mr. Grinch. Your heart's an empty hole. Your brain is full of spiders. You've got garlic in your soul, Mr. Grinch. I wouldn't touch you with a 39.5-foot pole.
All I need is a reindeer. The Grinch looked around, but since reindeer are scarce, there was none to be found in that store.